Good morning.
Morning.
You can hear me.
Yes,
well, good morning, everybody. It's so good to see you all here. We got a number of visitors this morning. If I pronounce your name wrong, forgive me. We have Gordon and Judy Bury. Gordon is Sean's dad. Is very pleased to have you with us. Tracy Bailey. Nice to have you, Tracy. I don't know if I'll say it. Amsdeep Kaur.
Arsh,
okay. Judy Nickel. Wavy Avery. Brenda Moore. Christina Dirtle, Sean's mom. Brittany Dirtle, Sean's sister. And Ryan Dix, Brittany's fiance. Wow. Boy, it's so good to see you all here this morning. Sean, I don't know if you should have another dedication in a month's time.
Two for one.
Yeah, you brought in a lot of visitors there, bro. Good to see you all with us. Brittany's man, Shirley, is here. So nice to have you with us, Shirley. Anybody else who I might have missed? I thought I saw Howard Decker coming, but I didn't, did I? Oh! Thought I saw you. I don't recognize green, so that's probably one. Anyway, folks, I'm happy to have you all here. We've got a few announcements. This is a special morning for Brittany and Sean, and we're glad that the family could be here to celebrate with them, okay? Tuesday morning at 9 o'clock is the breakfast time. So we'd like for the Alpers to get out a bit early, probably around 6:30. No, by 8 o'clock, 6:30 is prayer time here. We have prayer every Tuesday morning at 6:30. Wednesday night Bible study, we're gonna continue in the book of Ephesians. And we had to start last week. It's a beautiful Bible study. November the 26th is going to be a very special time here at the church when our kids are going to be doing a service.
Yeah.
And one of our young ladies is going to be speaking. So that's good. Savannah, yep. So that's wonderful. That's wonderful. So we're going to ask you to stand with us now as we next week. And there's food, fun, and fellowship next Sunday. And that's when we each bring along some food. And we always have lots of food. And you're all invited back, okay? Yes. So we're going to have prayer right now. And there's a couple of prayer requests that have come in. John Chatterton. John is home because in the last few weeks he hasn't been feeling well. He's going for some more testing. And John really needs our prayers. Okay, so let's pray for him. Also, Ruby Vetch, Bonnie's sister, is going through a very, very tough time this time. I think it's what, two aneurysms, and you know, we can't even imagine how serious something like that is. So we're going to pray, and we're going to ask God to do a miracle and touch these people and heal them for his glory. Father, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for everybody that have come out, Lord, to taking this service. We pray, God, that they will take something from this place, Lord, today, Lord, that will just register deep in their hearts and in their spirits. And may as a result of today, Lord, that they will be drawn closer to you. Now, Father, we pray for Ruby Vetcher and John. Father, you see the needs there now, and you see the urgency of these needs. Father, in Jesus' name, we ask you to come right now and touch them and let your healing power flow in their lives. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.
Well, good morning, everybody. Are we come expecting something here this morning? Are we ready to receive and to praise God this morning? It's good to see all of you. Kristen's not here this morning because she's really skinny. And like with the wind outside the way it is, we decided to keep her home because she might blow away. This is why I keep the weight on. You know, it keeps me grounded on these windy days, and it also makes it harder for me to be kidnapped. So it's okay to laugh in church, isn't it? Brothers and sisters, let's join together and worship God this morning. Amen. Clap along, sing along.
Darkness runs for cover. When you move, no one's turned away. 'Cause where you are, fear turns into praises. And where you are, no hearts left unchanged.
Here we go, come on.
So come, move, let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you. When you move, outcast finds a family. When you move, the orphan finds a home. Lord, here we are. Oh, teach us to love mercy with humble hearts. Bow down at your throne.
Sing it, church.
So come, move, let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you. Let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you. King of all generations, let every tongue and nation surrender all to you alone, to you alone.
Yeah.
King of all generations, let every tongue and nation surrender all to you alone, to you alone. Justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you.
Yes.
Oh, come, move, let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. nations. Let every tongue and nation surrender all to you alone. All you alone. Yeah. King of all generations. Let every tongue and nation surrender all to you alone. To you alone. So come, move, let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you. Justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you. Come, move, let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you. So come, move, let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you.
Father, we thank you, Lord, that we can come together, press into your presence in this place, and that as we worship, we get drawn closer and closer and closer to you, oh God. Be glorified in our praise this morning, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Do anyone need an envelope? Jagger has the envelopes, and I forget her name.
Bonnie, put it up there. Look.
Yes, sir.
Here you go. Gotcha.
Now we
can. I'm probably going to repeat myself again, but we are going to take up a portion of what God has blessed us with. And it's his tithes and your offerings. And we're so thankful that he has blessed us that we can give to him. And they're just going to pray. And I'm going to pray over offering. Lord, we just thank you, Lord. We are able to give, Lord, what you have given us, Lord. A portion, Lord, that you have blessed our lives with. And we're just thankful, Lord, for you in our lives, Lord, and for what you have done and what you're going to do. And Lord, we pray for this service today. And we pray for those who's here. We ask, Lord, that you just pour out a blessing upon them, Lord, and give them peace and comfort. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Surely goodness and mercy will follow me. Surely goodness.
struggle. You don't waste a single day.
Your presence is my shelter. Your presence is my victory. Around me, you prepare a table. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me. When I'm in a valley, I will fear no evil. When enemies surround me, you prepare a table. Surely mercy will follow me. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me. And I can't see it all, but I have seen enough to know.
Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus died and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh,
the third at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh Lord our God. You shall return in robes of white, the blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh Lord our God. Oh Lord, oh Lord our God. Oh Lord, oh Lord our God. You are
when you look back on your life, there are times, if you're paying attention, and hindsight is a beautiful thing, you know, but when I look back on my life, I can see very many examples of how God was there in my life, even when I didn't recognize it. Even when I was in the darkness of the dark of my life, I know now, looking back, that He was there. And there is evidence of that all around us. Amen? You got to be paying attention, folks. He is there even in the darkest times. And how great is it that we can be there after the fact and praise Him for how good He's been to us. Let's sing about the evidence that we see all around us. Amen. All throughout my history, Your faithfulness walked beside me. The winter storms made way for spring. In every season, from where I'm standing, I see the evidence of Your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see Your promises and fulfillment all over my life. Remember when I'm weak, fear may come, but fear will leave. You lead my heart to victory.
Just praise him this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Leave your baggage outside and just focus on the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Lord, we thank you this morning for the evidence that we have of everything in our life, having food on our table, Father, and the air that we breathe, Father, in a country we are free, Father God. Lord, we thank you today. We thank you we have a place to come and worship your name. We thank you, Lord, for that. Lord, we thank you that we can be free in our worship, yes. Father God. May your spirit be poured out upon this place because we seek for things of your spirit, Father. May your spirit move, oh God, and as it does, it transforms lives, Lord. I pray for lives to be transformed today. Lord, lives will be changed today by the power of your spirit. May your spirit move like never before. May your spirit move. It says, in the end days, I will pour out my spirit. Lord, we are accepting. We are prepared to receive from you today. Lord, as you minister to us and all God's children say it, amen. 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 I'm going to call on Brother Wayne. Dedication. Pastor Wayne. Brother Wayne.
Father Wayne. Good morning, folks. Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, I'm on again. Well, that's a beautiful song, and every time I sing that song, I think about my own life. And I go back over my life, and I can say for anybody else's, everybody got their own evidence. But I've got my own evidence of God's goodness. Yes. Now, this is a special day for Sean and Brittany and the family. You know, as we were sitting there, I just want just to make a mention of something for the family here today. Sean, if you would just sit down for a minute, please. And I know you're a bit nervous, but Sean got a roaming problem. Yeah. We love him, though. Let me tell you something. Oh, he's a great guy. But folks, as we sang that song today, and I just want to speak to Sean's family for a moment, because we know him here, but if you look at Sean and Brittany, you know something? That song, Evidence, is truly Sean's testimony.
Amen.
And I can only tell by a little bit that I know. Sean and I sat several times for coffee, and I've known Sean many years ago back in Bonavista when he spent time at my brother's house with Corey and Mitchell. And Sean's life has taken a lot of different directions since that time. And he'll be the very first to attest to the fact that, you know, only for God. How many times you say that to me, Sean? Yeah. Only for the goodness of God, I would not be where I am. True, Sean, isn't it? And you know what I like? What I like with Sean Burry is that Sean is Sean. But what I like most with Sean is that when Sean settled back and really got serious about the things of God, God started a process. Okay? Now, Sean hasn't reached his ultimate yet, let me tell you. God started the process, and as Sean grows in God, you will look and see, yeah, this is finally true. You know what I mean? Some people may say, well, give Sean 2 months. Give Sean 3 months. Give Sean 6 months. Give Sean a year. And Sean will be back doing the old thing. How long has it been, Sean? Almost 2 years. And Sean, how many times have you tried it on your own and it didn't work? Many times. Here's an example, folks, of what a life can do when you allow Jesus to step in and make the difference. Plus the fact that we've been very supportive of Sean. We've been non-condemning. And that's where we are. God is good. So let's get started. Okay, folks, you can come forward now and take your places like we talked about this morning. Where's Emerson to? Move forward. Where is our song leader this morning? Come over here, Emerson. Let me tell you something. This is a precious little boy. And this morning, and I'm going to say this, but I saw the kids just congregating over there, getting a little bit active in front of church. And sometimes, you know, some old fogies get annoyed with that. Yeah. Sorry. If you're an old fogey, you're going to suck it up, okay? But some people get annoyed because kids are allowed to roam a little bit and play a little bit with their toys in church. Listen, folks, if the day ever comes with new life that we don't allow these things, there will be one family that will be absent. I can guarantee you that. We love and appreciate Pastor James for doing this. So Emerson is going to lead us in a song. We want you all to stand. And he's going to sing, Jesus Loves Me, This I Know.
Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Do you know the verse?
Jesus loves me, this I know.
For the Bible tells me so. Little ones, the weary eye, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Let's give him a big hand, shall we? Thank you, buddy. Thank you very much. Folks, this is a very sacred time, a very important time. And as I take a few minutes to go through the process, just think about what we're saying, the commitments that we're making today as parents. And as godparents, okay? Dearly beloved, the family is a divine institution ordained of God from the beginning of time. Children are an heritage of God committed by Him to their parents for care, protection, and training for His glory. It is meet that all parents recognize this obligation and their responsibility to God in this matter. Pastor Sylvie is going to read some scriptures.
Before I read your scripture, I've just got to say one thing. I was listening to a program on TV last night on Daystar, and this pastor said, as a result of parents bringing their children to the Lord, that generations can be affected.
Yes.
Now, isn't that something? Just listen to that. And I thought about my own parents. My mom is 92 years old, and she has five generations. We have grandchildren and great-grandchildren, and that's five generations. And as a result of her commitment back when she was a teenager, that she has affected generations, at least five generations. Uh-huh. And that's so important when we bring our children and bring them up. And that can affect the world, right? The scripture says in the New Testament, we read concerning the infant Christ, that when 8 days were fulfilled, they called his name Jesus. And they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And he received him into his arms and blessed God and said, just listen to this because of Jesus. He said, now let thy servant depart in peace, for my eyes have seen thy salvation. And his father and his mother were marveling at the things that were spoken concerning him, Jesus, baby Jesus. And the child grew and waxed strong, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. You'll find these scriptures in Luke 2. Train up a child in the way he should go, and even when he is old, he will not depart from it. These words which I command you this day shall be upon my heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shall talk of them when you sit at your table, and when you walk in your house or in your garden, and when you lie down, and when you rise up, and you teach your children the word of God. May God bless this word to us.
Friends, this is a happy and a significant occasion which brings us together today. Like Mary and Anna of old, you have brought your child to the temple today to present him to the Lord. You have heard the invitation of the Master, suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of heaven. It is fitting that you bring your child today to be dedicated to the Lord. The mystery and wonder of this new life I brought you to stand reverently and thoughtfully before the Father of all life, and have given you a new and a compelling message of dignity, of life, and obligation of parenthood. The purpose of this service is to help you as parents to appreciate your obligations, so to train your child in the nurture and the admonition of God, that when she shall come to the age of responsibility, she will most naturally turn from the wrong to the right and accept Jesus Christ as her Savior and Master. Sean and Brittany, God has a purpose for this young life. Yes. Let me repeat it. Shauna Brittany, God has a purpose for this young life. To find that purpose and to live it out, what means success. To refuse or ignore it will mean failure, to no matter how much worldly acclaim may come. It is your privilege today and duty to guide your child in such a way as to make the will of God the greatest ambition of her life. To this task, you are called to consecrate yourselves today, and to this end, you dedicate your child to God. In accordance with the purpose for which you come, you will need to respond to the following covenant. Do you present your child before God in solemn dedication? Do you consecrate yourself as parents to bring up your child in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord?
We do.
Do you promise to instruct her in the teachings of Jesus Christ and the practice of prayer, and to guide her in the development of a childlike character?
We do.
Do you promise to try to your best ability to shape the home life of your child, both by family devotions and by your words and your example, that she will, at the proper age, most naturally come to a confession of faith in Christ and into the fellowship and service of the church? Godparents. Ryan and Brittany, so glad that you could be a part of this today. Pastor James and Miracle, so glad that you could be a part of this today. You have agreed to accept the spiritual responsibility of being godparents to this child, heir to be dedicated. Alongside your godchild's grandparents, will you give your time to be your godchild to talk to about the bigger questions of life, questions about hope and love? Will you pray for your godchild through the ups and the downs? There will be lots of their life and their faith journey. Pastor Sylvie, will you pray, please?
Father, we just thank you for this privilege, Lord, that we have this morning to bring this little one, Lord, to be dedicated to your will and to your purpose, Lord. And as Christian parents and Christian godparents and grandparents and whoever is connected with this child, pastors, church family, Lord, we just declare in Jesus' name that we will be with Brittany and Sean, Lord, in training this child.
Yes.
In the way they should go. And we will always pray for this family, Lord. And for Lord, Big Brother Emerson, Lord, we just thank you for his life and for the touch that you have on this family. And truly we can say, when we look around, we see the evidence of your goodness all over their lives, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your mercy. And we dedicate this child to you now, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Oh, my. Harlow Victory Nicove, we dedicate you today to the Lord in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Absolutely. God bless you all, folks. God bless you all. Just a second. I have some pictures, I think.
Oh, yeah. Come on, mother.
pictures with the family after.
I think that Sean wants to get some pictures with the family, so just hang around for a little bit after. Okay. And Brittany, of course.
Well, it's that time of service. Going to call the kids. Come on up. Emerson, you come back up. Yeah. It's okay. Don't worry about it. Just leave it there. Well, God has blessed us with a great kids ministry. And I want to thank Brittany and Val and the team that go out and assist with them because they are precious. Amen. But this is one of my favorite times of the service. Who wants to sing? Emerson, you got a song. I know you do. We're going to have start with Emerson and then we'll go around. But
I got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart. I got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart. Where? It's so happy and happy. I got the love of Jesus in my heart. And I'm so happy. So very happy. I got the love of Jesus in my heart.
Who else wants to sing? You want to sing?
We trust in you, Jesus, you're all, you're all, you're all that we need. Your power will pull us through. We trust in you, we're trusting in you. You give us hope and light that's forever. You make us bold and we stand together. Your power will pull us through. We trust in you, we're trusting in you.
Jesus loves me.
Wanna do it?
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Yet all one behind beyond, he is weak, but he is strong.
There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know. Everything I need, you got honey in the rock.
Amen. So let's pray. And remember, I forgot to say this, but parents, Wednesday night, the kids are taking over the service next Sunday. We're going to have a practice on Wednesday night for the kids. So whoever's involved, if they want to be involved, show up Wednesday night, okay? I'll make sure if you need rides, we'll get you here. All right, let's pray. 7 o'clock, okay? Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you for their lives, Father God. We pray as they go out, oh Father, that Brittany, what they share with them will stay with them in the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's children said,
Amen.
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 Actually, before I start preaching, can we just get up for a couple minutes and welcome each other? Get on your feet because you might be sitting for a while. No, just joking. I'm not going to keep you that long. But get up for a while. Give everybody a great big God bless you and a new life welcome. Amen? 2 to 3 minutes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Is that good? Can you hear me okay? Welcome, bud. Amen. You may be seated.
All right, that's enough of that.
Trip up in this for sure. Good morning, church. Can you all hear me okay? Good, good. If you haven't been a part of our congregation, I just want to let you know, they all know is if I get a response, I'm usually not as long in preaching. But if I don't get a response, there you go. If I don't get a response, then it means you're not getting it. So maybe I need to explain myself a little more. But today, I promise I won't keep you too long. But we were blessed this morning. We were blessed to witness, actually, the newest member of Harlow being dedicated to Christ. You know, it's a very, it's a heart searing thing for the church. You know, but we should all as a church, I know myself as a godparent will be praying for Harlow and helping her in her upbringing. But we as a church family, we should be blessing Sean and Brittany as they lead the family into the truth of God's word and the ways of Jesus. Amen. Last week, guys, if you weren't here last week, and we had a tremendous time in the Spirit. You know, I mean, I haven't experienced that since I, little bits here and there, but since I was a little boy, you know, we were blessed to have Pastor Lionel Santana. And hopefully he's coming back in April. We're going to see if we can get him back here for April or March of next year. And we had Pastor Mario on Friday and Saturday, and God moved in a mighty way. But it didn't stop on Saturday. Our very own Pastor Sylvia preached a powerful message last week about the family. And it was impactful. And we seen again God move in the place. And a lot of answers over this weekend were answered for some people. Some people needed confirmation on things. And God came through with answers for them. But, you know, I mean, I'm just so happy that where we were. But God revealed it to me. It wasn't the minister that brought the Spirit. He comes prayed up, but it was our hunger. Many hours that we spent in prayer. And when we came here, anybody who came when the evangelist was here, if I asked them, are you prepared to receive? Everybody in the service was prepared and ready to receive. See, the Spirit is always here. You have the Spirit of God within you. You need to stir that up. You know, I mean, some people, well, the anointing is on the inside of you. The glory follows the anointing, but when we come with open arms and open hearts to receive from God, that's when he starts to move. Because it's hard to receive if you have your arms crossed. A little loud. arms crossed and your mind is not with you. Your mind's on your work or the situation or a family issue. It's very hard. But when you put your focus on Jesus, when you put your focus on him and when you come into his presence and you only focus on him, things change. The atmosphere changes. I've seen this growing up, you know, fond memories as a kid. I call it the old time Pentecost, and I actually mentioned this to some people. I said, I haven't seen it since a little boy, but I remember as a little boy in a Pentecostal church in Birch Bay, Newfoundland, where the Spirit of God would come and it would change people, salvations, you know, I mean, just because we were ready and prepared to receive. This morning, for a short while, though, I want to continue on the series that I've been talking about. I've been speaking on for the last 4 weeks prior to the weekend. It's about breaking the offense in every stronghold. You know, I covered 6 steps of the 8, and today I'm going to cover the other 2. But anybody remember what the 6 steps were? Number 1, I'm going to go through with them really quickly. Be alert. Be alert. Number 2, take captive. Number 3, resist the thought. Number 4, stand firm on the word. Number 5, stand in faith. Number 6, we talked about the week before last, put on the full armor of God. And we went through the armor and what it represents and what it can do. That being said, who here is expecting to hear from God this morning? If you are, turn with me to Acts 2, verse 42. Acts 2, verse 42. While you're looking, I just want to pray. Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you, Father. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your spirit, Lord. Lord, I pray that I become small. Make my tongue as that of a ready writer, Father God. As I write, as I speak, oh God, you write it on their hearts, Father God, and it goes into good soil. And may your spirit have your way. If he needs to turn this service upside down, turn it upside down, inside out. Just spirit have your way in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Acts chapter 2, verse 42. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and breaking of bread and to gossip. I'm making sure you guys are with me this morning. I just want to make sure you're with me. It doesn't say that. Very good, Chris. You're listening. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together, and they had everything in common. They sold their property and possessions and gave to anyone who had need. Every day they broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all God's people. And the Lord added to their numbers daily those who were saved. Today I want to look at number 7 and 8. I'm going to do it really short. I'm not going to be long. But number 7, I had remain in unity and prayer. And number 8 is the last and final thing. But sometimes we need to realize who we are in Christ Jesus. And we need to take back what the enemy tried to steal from us. And we have the authority to do so through Christ. Amen? See, there's something about a people who pray. There's something about a person who goes to God. You know what I mean? A time spent in prayer. And they walk in the word. See, when you pray to God in your word, when you walk in love and unity, there's always victory at the end. There's always a victory for you. Looking back at the scripture I just read in Acts chapter 2, this is taking place at almost like a local church. And you notice it happened just right after the day of Pentecost. If you look at Acts chapter 2, that's when the day of Pentecost happened. You know what I mean? And then Peter quoted the prophet. Joel, he says, in the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. And your sons and your daughters will prophesy. And your young men will see visions. And your old men will dream dreams. Even my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days. And they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Signs on the earth below. Fire and blood and billows of smoke. The sun will turn into darkness and the moon to blood. Therefore, the coming of the great and glorious day of our Lord. See, everything is unfolding before our eyes. There's no doubt about it. We are moving towards the last day. But I am a firm believer in the last day. I believe this.
God will pour out his spirit to those who are willing to receive. But we got to be willing to receive it. Amen. See, yes, we together, they prayed. You know, if you look at it, they were together and they prayed. The next verse, they said they weren't just saying grace. You know what I mean? It's good to say grace. Say your grace. Be thankful for what the Lord's given it. But it's not a ritual thing. They weren't just praying and saying grace and saying a brief prayer before they go to bed. They were meditating on the word. They were praying. You know what I mean? They dedicated their lives to God. Hallelujah. And everyone was filled with awe and wonders, the signs were performed. See, you notice something here? You notice in the scripture it didn't say signs and wonders and then they prayed. Here it says there was prayer and time together. Before then they seen the signs and wonders. Like we had last weekend. What happened last weekend, I'm sure Pastor Mariel spent a lot of time in the secret place. Pastor Lionel spent a lot of time in the secret place. We on a Tuesday morning spent a lot of time in corporate prayer, believing for a move of God. And God showed up, and he always does when we expect him, when we are prepared to receive him. Amen. Hallelujah. Church, there's something. There's something about God, men and women who pray. Not only in public, not to be seen, but go in your secret place. When you go in your secret place, many times in my life, I thank God that I had a mother who prayed. How many people here thank God that they had a mother who prayed? You know what? Believe it or not, your pastor wasn't always the best person. I wasn't the most righteous, and I'm not, only through him. I made mistakes in my life, but I had a mother. And many times I could be going down a dark road and I felt God. Even though I wasn't living right, I wasn't doing everything I could for him, I still felt because I had a mother behind the scenes in prayer probably many nights that I was out having a good time. But I had a mother who prayed for me. And I know it kept me safe and kept me out of harm. And actually, if you're here today and you have lost loved ones and you are praying, I am living proof that God answers prayer. God answers prayer. Amen. While I was studying this, God showed something to me. He showed something to me, and this is the words that came out of my spirit. If we can only pray on the mountaintop like we do when we're in the valley. You ever notice when we're in the valley? Let me explain myself. When we're in the valley, there seems like a pressing on God. We need something. There's a loved one that are sick or something. You know, you go before God more than you do when you're on the top, because when you're on the top, everything is going smoothly. But God showed me if we only spent the time on the mountaintop to pray just as much as we did when we're in the valley, we wouldn't be in the valley as much, because there's a lot of answers in prayer. A lot of answers when you're on the mountaintop and everything's going good. Like Pastor Lionel said on when we were in St. John's, it's easy to thank him when your fridge is full. But when your fridge is empty in the desert place. But when we're on the mountain, we should be consistent, God. God is looking for a consistent people. He's not looking for a people who call my name when you want to call, when you need me. He's there, always there to answer. But he needs a people that are consistent. Consistent both in the mountain and on the valley. Because there's answers in your mountain that will steer you from your valley. Keep you out of harm's way. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Church, in the good and bad, he inhabits our praises. In the good and the bad, he inhabits our praises. Myself included, need to spend more time in prayer. See, if I did, I probably wouldn't find myself being attacked so much. Because when you're close to God, and you're close to him, and you're walking in his love, things don't stick to you the same. Things don't stick to you the same. I'm talking about offense. Because the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. We know that. But when you walk in the love of God, when that enemy comes to throw an offense at your way, it's easy to brush it off, because God, you're looking at it through God's eyes and not your flesh. If we can only walk in the ways of Christ. Hallelujah. See, the enemy never quits, no matter if you're on the mountain or in the valley. Actually, he probably works twice as hard when you're on the mountain, because he wants to knock you down to the valley. He wants you down and out. Down and out, you're not much of a threat. Right? So he wants to knock you down. He wants to tear you down. He'll use everything against you, even your closest friends and family. He'll use against you. You know, the enemy, like I said, comes to steal, kill, and destroy everything that God has for you. And the two of his greatest weapons is pride and disunity. Pride and disunity. You notice I said pride first? Because pride usually starts first. It all starts with, you know what I mean? And this is where Christ, thank God Christ didn't go to the cross and say, what about me? Thank God he didn't go to the cross and said, what about me? You know, but he looked and he said, Father, forgive them, right? That's what he said. But it all starts with pride. You know, words like, look what they did to me. You see what they said about my family? You see how they treated me? There's a lot of me's in there. But Jesus, you know, he was beaten. He was bruised. He was whipped. And he hung on a cross. And it's something he never ever did. You know what I mean? He never performed anything wrong. But he still said, even though he knew he wasn't wrong, he still said, Father, forgive them. If we only could have that today in our hearts. See, in Matthew 12 and 25, Jesus was talking to the Pharisees. He was talking about, they were saying, Beelzebub is, you know, the work of the devil, casting out demons. And in 25, Jesus says, knowing their thoughts, he said to them, every kingdom divided against itself is laid to waste. And no city or house is divided against itself will stand. Then in verse 30, he goes on in verse 30, whoever is not with me is against me. And whoever does not gather with me scatters. So what he's saying here, you look at our modern day life. If yes, you say we're with God, but do we spend time with his word? If you have a relationship with him, are you praying every day? You know, are you seeking the things of the Spirit? Are you spending time in his presence? Because how do you have a relationship with somebody if you're not spending time with them? You can't have a relationship with somebody if you're not spending physical or talking to them. It's not a relationship. But that's what God desires from us. And he knows, the devil knows if he can get in and get us disunity in the church or us fighting against other denominations. Guys, we're past that. We're past that. We are all for the glory of God, and we're all to seek lost souls and people that are hurt in the town of Clarenville that need Jesus. And here they are sometimes, and they see us as a church bickering amongst ourselves or bickering against other denominations. It's time for us to stop it. If God's going to move in Clarenville, he needs to see a church. He needs to see a godly men and women that come together united, strong. Put aside what beliefs. Look at the love of Jesus. We all believe in Jesus. We believe he died for us. Let's start with that foundation. Amen? Church, I know we live in the last days, like I said, and we're going to see a moving God. But he's rising up glorious churches without spot or wrinkle. You know, come, because like Pastor Wayne said, it's a process sometimes. You know what I mean? He takes us from glory. He's not finished with me. There's work that needs to be done in me, but me accepting, Lord, I need you. Make me perfect. I am empty. I am soft. I am not coming to you hard. Mold me, because he can't mold hard clay. When you're prideful, you are hard, and he cannot mold hard clay. So we soften ourselves and say, Lord, do a work in me and use me as a vessel. Sometimes his work through you may hurt. May hurt a little. You may be pressed in certain areas. You may have to renew your mind what the word says sometimes. That hurts. I've been there. But united we stand. Divided we fall. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. See, I want to get back on the offense. The enemy works through pride. And he just pokes that little wedge in there. It's maybe something little. But then, you know, when you have a little thing, and then something happens, it becomes bigger. In your own eyes, it becomes bigger than what it really is. I've been there. I've done it. You know what I mean? I've seen people, you know, even within the church, attack other people in my family from the church. But every little thing that I seen then was, wow, when it wasn't wow, But the devil made it wow in my eyes to bring me further away from the church. And what happens is slowly but slowly, just little bit by little bit. And then I find myself, I don't want nothing to do with the church. I don't want nothing to do with it. They don't appreciate people. Just that atmosphere. But see, my focus, there's a lesson to this. My focus wasn't on God. My focus wasn't on God. My focus was on people. If you focus on people, I will tell you today, we will surely fail. No man can give you your salvation. Only Jesus Christ through him. Hallelujah. It's a basic message, but there's so much in there. If we can only apply it. The second part of my sermon is sometimes we need to take back what the enemy has stolen. Take back what the enemy has stolen. In doing this, I want to look at the story of Joseph. Anybody know the story of Joseph? He had that great coat, many colors. You know, but his father blessed him. But the brothers became jealous and wanted to kill him and decided to sell him. Instead of killing him, they faked his death and sold him into slavery. Imagine how Joseph felt. Your brother's selling you to slavery. You could probably look at God, why are you letting this happen to me? He was put in prison. He went through some pretty hard times in his life. But see, he remained true to God. And I will show you in the verse where he says he's remained true to God. They wanted to kill him, but God had restored, actually worked through Joseph through the whole time. And you know, at the end, he became the ruler of Egypt. Because he had something, he had God to help them interpret the dream that Pharaoh had. Can you turn with me to Genesis 50, 18 to 21? Genesis 50, 18 to 21. His brothers, now they're talking about the brothers. This is all after it all came to pass. These ruler, the brothers came and threw themselves before him, says, "We are your slaves," they said. But Joseph said to them, see, this is the heart of God, right? "Don't be afraid. I am in the place of God." Church, we need to get in the place of God. In our circumstances, we need to get in. What he's saying, he's not saying he's God. He's in the place of God. He's walking with God in the Spirit of God and in the love of God. That is Genesis 50, 18, 21. Yeah, 50. Yeah. Maybe it's my Newfoundland accent. Did I sound like 15? 50? 50? But you understand, he was in a, what he meant by he was a place of God. He was walking in God. He was walking in a unity because no man, you imagine if we were in that situation, your brother sold you to slavery. You went through time in prison, the hard times. And now you're restored and you're somebody and these people are coming back to you. Only the love of God shown through him for him to say, "I forgive you." Not only did he forgive them, listen to what he does. "So don't be afraid, I will provide for you and your children." He didn't know he would forgive them, but he said, "Now I'm going to bless you." And he reassured them and spoke to them kindly. He didn't push them away. Church, we need to stop pushing people away that hurt us sometimes. Because don't look at, like I said, don't look at the person. Look at the enemy behind, working behind the person. Start praying against the enemy. Because he will use the people closest to you sometimes to have offense in your life. You know, I see Joseph, God working behind the scenes. He knew, he had to know that God was his way maker. He had to know, even though he didn't feel like things were working better for his behalf, there was something happening behind the scenes. God was working behind the scenes. I'm here to tell you today, no matter what you're going through, you call on the name of Jesus, he will work behind the scenes. He will work on your behalf. All we need to do is long for him. Love him and spend time with him. See, the devil, even back in Genesis, we see, used offense and strongholds of Joseph's brothers to try to steal, kill, and destroy Joseph. But, you know, he's still on the prowl today. You know, whoever he may devour, but God gave us a promise. This is one of my wife's favorite scriptures. Jeremiah 29:11. A lot of us know it by heart. "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for your welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope." If you need a promise to stand on this morning, stand on that promise. "I have plans for you," He has a plan. He has a plan even for Harlow when we dedicated Harlow this morning. He has a plan. Even in your mother's womb, you have a plan for God's work. If we could only cast away offense before it comes a stronghold. Like I said, when it becomes rooted, offense starts as a seed. Then it becomes rooted. And then it becomes to a point where a seed is easy to brush off or kick out of the ground. But once that seed gets rooted, it becomes sometimes like a tree. You're going to need more. You can't. Sometimes you can try to do it on your own, but you need the power of God to remove it. Remove it. That's the reason why the Bible says, resist the devil and he will flee. Resist him early. Don't hold on to it when that offense comes. Don't hold on to it and hover it and water it. Because when you water it and you hover onto it, it begins to grow on you. And when it begins to grow on you, next thing you know, you've got a tree in your life and you can't get by it. You can't pluck it out on your own. You need the power of God to restore it to you. But he can, and he will. Amen? Like I said, Jesus, we need to cast everything down. See, and I've seen many friendships. I've seen families, relationships torn apart because of offense. They last way too long without forgiveness. And sometimes family members have passed on, and we've never had a chance to say sorry. If you're in that situation, listen, don't be too big to say you're sorry. Jesus wasn't too big. Jesus wasn't too big to say he was sorry. You know, look, but you, Pastor, you don't realize what he did or she did to me. And I probably don't. But all I can tell you is, like Jesus, when he went to the cross, he did nothing wrong, but he took a beating. He took stripes on his back for your healing. He didn't say, oh, well, look at them. He took it for you, even though he did nothing wrong. Thank God. You know, he was chastised for our peace. People here looking for peace in their lives, look at what Jesus done before he went to the cross. He was beaten for your peace of mind. But never ever did he hold a grudge and say, you know what, I'm going to destroy mankind. He could have called down 10,000 angels. He could have. Hallelujah. But still, he hung on that cross. And he bore your sin. I think the most greatest thing, he bore all of our sins. Can you imagine a man bearing everybody's sin at once? Every addiction, every sickness, everything that comes with sin all at once. Can you imagine the weight that he had to bear? But still, he said, he looked to the Father and he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He could have said, Father, I've had enough. I'm done with these people. They treated me like garbage. Don't they know I'm here to help them? But all they do, they're treating me like garbage, Father. Destroy them. He could have did that. But thank God he didn't. But we have to walk the same way as Christ. That's the reason why the Bible says walk in the ways of Christ. Be like Jesus. It's not easy to do. It's not easy to turn the other cheek. But that's what the world, the flesh would say. An eye for an eye. You have to get revenge. They did something wrong to you, you have to get revenge. No, that's not what we preach here. When we say we turn the other cheek and we do it in love, and not only do it with love, we do what Joseph did. We turn around and forgive them and give them a blessing. Yes. Amen. Give them a blessing. If we could only have the heart of Christ. I know it's not easy to forgive. But when we do, see, there's a restoration process that happens in that. I always said, forgiveness is not for the one you're forgiving. Forgiveness is for you. Yeah. If you're harboring something in your heart and you forgive somebody, you are letting go. You are letting go of that. You know, I'm going to tell you a story. See, there's healing in forgiveness. My wife has stood here before you, and we talked about how God changed our lives when we lived in Mississauga, and we were living basically in a negative balance out of our paycheck. There was two revelations that we got, and I brought to my wife this week. One of them was our giving. We changed the way we gave. We got revelation on giving to God and receiving. We got that revelation. But in that, my wife looked to me, and you know the story of her father. Her father wasn't the nicest person. Her father tried to rape her. Wasn't around in her life. Very short, only the short period that he was around in her life, he wasn't the best of men to her. But she looked at me, I'll never forget it, in Mississauga, in the condo where we were renting, and she looked at me, she goes, I have to forgive my father. Not an easy thing to do. Not an easy thing to do. So she spoke it out. She goes, Lord, I forgive my father for what he did to me with a sincere heart. You know what? Things maybe didn't change in his life, but changed in ours because she spoke it. We need to learn how to speak some things sometimes. Even if you don't feel like it, speak it with faith. Call those things that are not as they are. Right? If we can get to them. And we just seen, God just blessed us. Shortly after that, raise after raise. You know what I mean? God just started an increase in this. But I'm a firm believer, not only through our giving, but because she had a heart to say, Lord, whatever is done, I forgive it. I look towards you. I don't look at my flesh, but I look at the love that you had for mankind. And we're here today. And we're blessed to be here. See, I love Joel, the prophet Joel. He says in Joel 2:25 and 26, I want to repeat this to you, and I want you to read this scripture. Whenever you felt that the enemy has stolen something from you, I want you to go to this scripture because he's prophesying in the scripture. It says, I will repay, that's Joel 2:25-26. I will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten, and the great locusts, and the young locusts, and the locusts, and other locusts, and the locust swarm. My great army I sent you. You know he sent you angels? He has sent us angels from heaven to protect you and guide you and take back what the enemy has stolen. Too many of us have been in the ditches for way too long under the oppression of what the enemy has. But we have the authority through Jesus Christ. At that name, every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess. There is no other name under the name of Jesus. You have an issue, speak the name of Jesus. And if you haven't tried it, try it because it works. Because of the authority of who we have in him. You will have plenty to eat until you're full and you will praise the Lord. See, there's a condition. You praise the Lord of the Lord our God. And he has worked wonders for you. Never again will my people be ashamed. We should never be ashamed of the gospel. Because there's so many blessings. Church, it's time to take back what the enemy has stolen in the name of Jesus. But we have to walk in love, joy, peace, all the fruits of the Spirit to get these things. Like I said, it's hard for God to work in people that are hard. We must walk in love, unity, and the Spirit. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. You want freedom? Get in the Spirit. Get around the things of the Spirit. Walk in the Spirit. Walk in love. Walk in joy. There's something about joy. That's 2 Corinthians 3:17. You know, there's a song we used to sing in Sunday school. And I don't have an action course. I used to love it because I used to almost tear the arms off the guy that was next to me. But you remember the song where you say, when we all pull together? Does anybody ever remember that? When we all pull together, together, together. When we all pull together, the happier we'll be. For your work is my work and our work is God's work. When we all pull together, the happier we'll be. It's true. It's true. I was going to get Wayne up and do the exercise, but I might shake his arms off. But if we only work together, can we do that this morning? Can I challenge you as a church to work together? Your brother and sister, even though they did wrong to you, even though they've hurt you, because the forgiveness, like I said, is not for the person. It's for the healing process of what God can do in you. As I call the worship team. Maybe you're here today and life has not been a bunch of roses and a lot of sunshine for you. You know, maybe there's many people that have attacked you, spread lies about you, tried to destroy you, physically hurt you, verbally hurt you, which is even sometimes worse. And you look at it, and so maybe sometimes it may be people that say they're from a church. Don't look at the person, look at God. I'm here to tell you today that we have a Heavenly Father who loves each and every one of us. I want to say that again for people, everybody can hear me. We have a Heavenly Father that loves each and every one of us. Even in our perfections, He loves us. Even with our wrongdoings, He loves us. No matter where we are in our life, He is always there with open arms to welcome us. And we should be the same way as a church. And you might say, you know what, Pastor? I don't know. I've seen so much in my lifetime. I've seen so much hurt. And I'm going through so much stuff. And why would God care for a person like me? You are precious in His sight. With every head bowed and every eyes closed. See, the answer that we have is free. And there's no condition, more or less. It's just you give what you have to Him. Give what you have to Him. Give your life to Him. That's where it's at. If you want freedom, it's not going to always be a bed of roses. But listen, you have the name of Jesus and that peace that can come upon you that passes all understanding. Give your problems to Him this morning. Is anybody here that want to receive Him as your Lord and Savior? I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. I'm not going to ask you to come to the front. I'm not going to embarrass you in any way, shape, or form. But I want to give you the opportunity to have that freedom this morning. A freedom of all the hurt that you may have experienced in your life. If you want to receive Him, I'm just going to ask you to raise your hand. We're going to say a simple prayer together. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Can we all repeat this prayer? Lord Jesus, I repent my sins. I surrender my life. Wash me clean. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that He died on a cross for my sins and rose again on the third day for my victory. I believe in my heart and make the confession with my mouth that Jesus is Lord and Savior. Hallelujah. If you repeated that prayer, you're now born again into a family. I'd love to meet with you after service if you want to talk for a brief bit of time. But I also want to pray this. Anybody here who has unforgiveness in their hearts, and we're all going to pray it. You don't need to raise your hands, but I want you to search your heart now deep down inside. Has anybody ever hurt you? Has anybody ever came against you? I want to ask for God to saturate us with His Spirit. And we can walk in His love. Can we just repeat this prayer? Lord, I forgive the ones that hurt me.
Lord, I forgive the ones who hurt me.
I speak a blessing over them and their families.
I speak a blessing over them and their families.
Teach me to walk in Your Spirit.
Teach me to walk in Your Spirit.
So I can find freedom.
So I can find freedom.
And the joy,
that only You can give.
Restore unto me, the joy of my salvation. And renew a right spirit within me. That I may take back what the devil has stolen in my life and replace it with the fullness of Your Son, Jesus. Because the victory I have today is in that name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Be blessed. Be blessed. Be blessed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
God is good.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
How amazing is the grace of God in our lives and the freedom that comes with it. There's freedom in the grace of God. Stand with us now and let's sing about amazing grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet.
Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
Church, be blessed this week. I speak blessing over each and every one of you and your families. Go and love on somebody and walk in the grace and the love of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Lord, Father, we just want to thank you, Lord, for your amazing grace, oh God. Thank you for that your grace and mercy are newer every day, oh God. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that the flow of love is in us because, Lord, that's your territory, oh God. Lord, the unforgiveness is not your territory. So, Lord, we thank you that we have love in our family right now, oh God. Lord, we speak blessing coming in and going out, oh God, for those people, oh God. And Lord, no weapon forms against us shall prosper, O God. That, Lord, our cup is running over, O God. Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow everyone today, O God, and their family, O God, all the days of their life, O God. And, Lord, we thank you, Lord. We trust you, O God, this week, O God. And, Lord, we thank you, Lord. We thank you. All the glory, all the honor to you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.